Hi, I'm John Atack, and yet again I am thrilled and delighted to have Karen de la Carrière with me on the show.
There were two outrageous missions, the Boston Postulate Check mission and Battle of Britain.
Yeah.
And I talked to one of my dearest friends, Janice Grady, who was a messenger since she was 12 years old.
Gillum.
Yep. The Gillum family. And she was with him 7-8 hours a day for like 12 years.
Yeah.
Hubbard ran those missions, Postulate Check missions. And that Hubbard was literally, see, he may have done it through Diana as a cutaway.
Yeah, exactly. Just as the mafia do.
Yeah, a cutaway. A level of your hands are clean, someone else. Yeah, so back to the earlier sentence I gave, metrics, money. Cash is supreme. Cash is Scientology's biggest want.
Mm. Yeah.
Not your personal gain, not even any welfare of taking care of the staff who produce the money.
No.
Staff go to Freeby County Medical. Mm. One of the biggest universities here in Los Angeles is called University of Southern California, known as USC, University of California. And they have a big med school. And their student doctors need to practice on people, guinea pigs.
Yeah.
And Scientology for years sent ships. I knew a girl with a brain tumor at Celebrity Center, the back of a thing, a brain youngster, 24. Oh, Scientology isn't going to pay for that. USC, the student doctors, but there are a lot of hobos and tramps that also go there because it's free.
I was going to say, it's the homeless members of Scientology.
You sit on a bench for 6 hours before you're seen because it's a freebie. So Scientology not only not pay taxes and gouge the maximum amount of money they can extract from any member. Not only that, they then make the government that they don't pay taxes to pay in these med schools that are funded by the government. The government pay for all the abortions they had for 25 years were done by Planned Parenthood. Planned Parenthood is funded by the US government.
Yeah.
So Hubbard wrote a couple of really good issues on exchange and how you grow spiritually when there's true exchange. But Scientology rips off getting all the benefits of the police and the fire station, fire engine. They liberally use police when people, you know, show up. They've got photographs of every activist. If there's any demonstration, police are used, but they don't pay. They don't pay the city. And in the city of Los Angeles, which has a huge problem of homeless, not one thing dying goes to, oh God, to orphanages, to charity.
No, I mean,
it deems itself as a charity, but it's a money guzzling. It's not a charity.
No. I mean, there is so much, you know, I've often talked about double binds in Scientology, that perhaps the thing that kept us stuck were these terrible contradictions. So Hubbard, for example, said that money in and of itself is not a product. It's not something you should be seeking to produce, unless, of course, you work at the mint where you make money. And yet the governing policy of Scientology is make money, make more money, make others produce so as to make even more money, or words to that effect. And it just, this list of things, I didn't see that when I was a member. There's so much of this stuff that you only see what's on the courses you do. And after I left and started you know, pulling material together, I was so shocked by many things I found. And as you said, the idea is that if you don't give something in return for what you receive, then you are out ethics and things will go badly wrong for you. And things have gone badly wrong for Scientology. So maybe there was some slight truth in that. But the reality is that when Ron Hubbard died in 1986, he had acquired $648 million, all of it from Scientology. He did not earn money by selling books. The books were funded by Scientology. I mean, St. Martin's Press were paid. They bought 40,000 hardback copies of Battlefield Earth, were purchased in advance, and they were given $250,000 to spend as they chose. Somebody called them a reputable publisher the other month, and I was talking to them. It's like, yeah, well, not then they weren't. They were willing to be, you know, bribed into producing this book, which, as we know, was then bookstores were receiving boxes of the book back from Scientology, which already had their price labels on, showing that Sea Organization members were being sent in to buy it to get it onto the bestseller list. This is not, you know, he also said clean hands lead to a happy life. And his hands were filthy from the very first moment. He was never telling the truth. He was determined to make money for himself. And he never subscribed to charity. He did nothing charitable or helpful that I've ever heard of in the, you know, the, what, 47 years now since I first met Scientology. I've heard of nothing that he did to help homeless people or orphans or wastes and strays in any way. He was entirely selfish. And maybe that's a good segue into looking at the kind of person who becomes a cult leader.
Yeah.
People who are narcissistic, people who are unloving, people who do not have empathy for others, but people who need to be adulated. You know, Eric Fromm, who gave us the term malignant narcissist, said that it was a mistake to call such people narcissists because they don't love themselves. They have no idea of how to love. Mm-hmm. And looking at the way that Ron Hubbard rejected his children, his wives, you know, his friends, that nobody really remained close to Ron Hubbard. And he would, you know, there's tragic stories about Mary Sue Hubbard, who signed a 200-page confession so that, you know, she would go to prison and he wouldn't. That was the whole reason for her doing it. She admitted guilt so that he wouldn't have to go to prison. She served her time in prison. She then tried to contact him. He refused to see her, his own wife, the mother of four of his children.
He never did see her again after.
And he issued an order that any correspondence from her should be photocopied, and anything that was unpleasant, what he called N theta, should be razor bladed out. And so there are all these letters that, so I'm told, read, "Dear Ron, love Mary Sue." And, you know, I think when he died, she was given $1 million from the $648 million. And just, you know, she'd been cast off. And I'm not a big fan of Mary Sue Hubbard either. I must say, I've heard of awful things that she did. And she was involved with the Guardian's office. But I still don't think that, having shown such profound loyalty, she should have been discarded in that way. And if you then look at the children, Quentin killed himself. Entirely because of mistreatment by his father. It can't be looked at any other way. I'm not really sure what happened to Suzette, but she's not in Scientology anymore. Diana.
Oh, Suzette lives down the road from me. Mm-hmm.
There you go. Well, she's, pop in and say hello to her.
She won't do any Scientology. She keeps well away from it.
Now, go ahead. Going through the children, Roanne, who was John Horwich and Diana's daughter at the age of, what, 7 or 8, Jesse Prince, when he talked at our seminar in Toronto, the Getting Clear seminar in 2015, he explained that he'd gone and persuaded Diana to assign her daughter to Scientology. So at the age of 7 or 8, Roanne lost her mother as a consequence of Ron Hubbard having decided that she would be the heir In fact, the last genuine will and testament of L. Ron Hubbard left everything to Roanne. And that's something that David Miscavige managed to get pushed to the side. And then that leaves you with Arthur Conway Hubbard, who I think is still in Los Angeles. And yes, who
down the road from me.
He has a website where he shows drawings of nude women, which he has made in his own blood. And
he uses blood.
Which I find a little bit odd, I must say. Ron Hubbard had almost nothing to do with his children. You know, the same for the children from his first marriage, Katie Gillespie and L. Ron Hubbard Jr. With Alexis Valerie, the daughter by the second wife that he never had, he sent her a letter saying that she wasn't his daughter. And, you know, given her physical resemblance to him, that does seem, you know, he didn't care about his own family. He abandoned Nibs in, 1942. He stopped paying anything when Nibs was 8 years old. He was not a good man. He was a man who wanted adulation, who wanted people to worship and love him. And when he didn't get that adulation, and I interviewed many people over the years who talked about his crying fits, you know, how John McMaster, the world's first real clear, said he found him sitting in the corner of the room sobbing because John had received so much applause, you know, because John was so popular. And Ron was upset about that. I think the thing for me was that and for many of us, you want somebody to be a hero. You want them to be ideal. You want them to be a role model, a Buddha, a Jesus, the Prophet Muhammad, however one visualizes perfection. And Ron Hubbard was the exact opposite of that. He was a degraded being. He was a suppressive person. He was somebody who was completely selfish and, you know, showed no care for those around him. And that is typical. If you look at Sun Myung Moon or Rajneesh, who called himself Bhagwan, the supreme god. I really shocked a Hindu when I said, hey, do you know about Bhagwan? He said, the supreme god. No, Rajneesh, you know, this sneaky little man. Throughout history.
Is he still alive, Bhagwan Rajneesh?
No, he only lived to be 58 years old, though he looks very old in the pictures of him. And I think he peaked at 96 Rolls Royces. And whenever he was allowed to drive one, he'd crash it because he was stoned out of his gourd on nitrous oxide and diazepam. Fascinating and evil character, but this need for adulation is central. You sent a list of points and
part two of this money. The Scientology entity is a money extortion racket.
Money making.
I don't think anyone that views this would disagree with that, even if you're still in, you have been gouged for money nonstop. Absolutely, 23 phone calls a week to say, can we have a little more money for this, for that? It's full-time money extortion. Now, the other side of the coin is what they do sell you for very high dollar can be quite outrageous. One guy called me up, he had used up $3,000 to confess to one masturbation cost $3,000 the cult gouged in from him, because masturbation is considered a crime. You touch your own body for touching your own body. I know that the Catholics had a thing for little boys, your willy will fall off if you keep playing with it.
So the priest played with it instead, but let's not go there.
but the point is that Scientology uses your hard-earned cash This is all poetic nonsense. Man is basically good. Hubbard says man is basically good, but 90% of Scientology is to find your evil, to find your crimes.
Hi, John here. Thanks for watching. We'd appreciate it very much if you would click like, as well as subscribe, and click the bell for notifications. Every dollar helps, and we welcome new patrons on Patreon, or you can make a one-off payment with any currency through PayPal. Thanks so much.